Welcome back to Arise 360. He's the funny man you'll know from the hit HBO series Silicon Valley and the movie Patriots Day.
That is right. Now he's keeping his fans laughing in his new book, How to American an Immigrant's Guide to Disappointing Your Parents.
Love it.
Actor, comedian, and author Jimmy Yang, welcome to Arise 360.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you for being here. We have to talk about first your character on Silicon Valley.
Yes.
Is hilarious. I mean, he does it all. But for those who don't know, tell us a little bit about your character and the show.
Mm-hmm. So Silicon Valley is a show based on the tech world in Silicon Valley. It's mm-hmm. a satire by Mike Judge, who actually wrote the foreword in my book.
Wow.
And that was amazing. He's always been one of my heroes. He did Office Space, you know, King of the Hill, Beavis mm-hmm. and Butthead. And the show centers around this group of engineers, software engineers. And I play one of them that lives in the hacker house. His name is Jing Yang, and he's a fresh off the boat kind of immigrant, which is basically me playing a version of myself 15 years ago.
We have the same last name, so.
Is it a caricature version of you or like a real life version of you?
It's real life. You know, when I first came to this country when I was 13 years old, I couldn't really speak English very well.
Oh, really?
I didn't even know, like, I'd learned English on paper, but I didn't know any slangs. Like, a girl came up to me and said, "What's up?" Like, we don't think about that. I say what's up every day now, but they don't teach you that in school.
Like, what is up?
Yeah, so I literally looked up. I'm like, what's up? What are you
like,
doing? Yeah.
But tell us, what is it like getting paid to have so much fun?
Oh, it's awesome. That show, Silicon Valley, I mean, everyone, it's also almost getting paid for an education, you know? Because everyone is such a great writer, mm-hmm. you know, such a great improviser, and we just have a ton of fun, ton of takes that, you know, we just kind of mess around. It's amazing.
I was wondering, I was like, do you guys spend most of the show just trying not to laugh or laughing at each other?
I mean, we always burst out laughing on live TV, so I can only imagine how much worse it is when it's pre-taped and you know you can mess up.
I think that's the hardest part of my job, is trying not to laugh.
Yeah. Yeah.
And a lot of us are stand-up comedians, so we like to gauge the audience, so I try to make the other person laugh, and if they do, even though the take might not work, I know I did pretty good. I try to make the producers in Video Village laugh, you know, and a lot of us can't hold it together.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I love it. Now, tell us more about this book, How to American, because the title in and of itself is brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like I've already completed this, How to Disappoint
Your
Parents.
Have you disappointed your parents?
Oh, yes.
Okay, good.
Many times over. But how is it that you managed to keep us all laughing so much? What went into this book? What was the inspiration for it?
Yeah, so I started as a stand-up, and it's great. It's really fun, but stand-up has a format. You got to just make people laugh every few seconds or so, but I want to write something more honest, yet humorous at the same time, you know? Mm-hmm. And sharing my story and my journey, you know, coming to America. So I moved here from Hong Kong to Los Angeles when I was 13 years old.
Wow.
You know, I think 13 is a weird age for anyone.
Yes.
Right.
Especially you gotta go to a new continent, make new friends, and learn a new language. Mm. So it starts there, and then it basically ends up, you know, the point where I disappointed my parents, where I was an economics major. I was graduating as an economics major, but I quit a finance job to do stand-up.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And
okay.
I almost cried.
We need to talk about this, because African parents are like, no creative industries. You must be a doctor, a lawyer, an accountant. That's it. And I know that Asian parents are very similar.
Yes.
What was your parents' response to that?
My dad is like, when are you going to go find a real job? He's been sending me careerbuilder.com emails. Even after I got on TV, he sends me job emails.
Even after you've been a successful actor, comedian, he's still sending
He's like, Jimmy, you know, Real People was hiring. Check my emails.
That's me.
That's not fair. You're doing it.
But I think it's not as noble to be an artist in, you know, the Chinese or the immigrant, the African community also, you know, because he grew up, like when I was growing up, he told me, he was like, you got to go get a real job, you know, get a good education, because being an artist is how you become homeless.
Oh.
He told me that.
But that just adds to your story. You know, you have to be homeless in order to be successful.
It's like,
exactly. You know. I never was homeless, but I was driving Uber while I was also living in this dude's living room for $300 that I rented from Craigslist.
Oh.
So that's close. I was on the brink
of
homelessness.
Pretty close. That's pretty close.
Pretty good, though.
Yeah.
But you were bound to have a career in the entertainment industry, surely.
Yeah, and they moved us here for the education of me and my brother, so it completely backfired for them.
Well, where did you get exposed to all the comedy and everything? Like, some people grow up watching things on, you know, comedy shows and listening to tapes. Where was your exposure to comedy?
So there was no stand-up comedy in Hong Kong whatsoever.
Okay, right.
The first time I saw stand-up was BET Comic View. When I first came to this country, like, BET was like opening a Pandora's box. Like, I'd never seen anything like that. Like, the hip-hop music videos and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, each 3-minute hip hop video was like a slice of American dream, right? Like Jay-Z's Big Pimpin', like on the yacht with like with like partying, champagne, all these women. It was so cool to me as a 13-year-old boy. And then when I saw Comic View, it wasn't just learning the language, it was also they were teaching me about culture, you know? Because like all the jokes they're talking about, the cultural jokes, the stereotypes, like black people do this, white people do that, Chinese people do that. I didn't even know there was a difference because in Hong Kong where I grew up, it was only Chinese people, you know? So I was learning about culture and the language from Comic View. And I guess that later on really inspired me to do what I do now.
I can imagine your 13-year-old self walking around the house talking about some Big Pimpin'.
Listen, I mean, I wasn't going to say anything about it, but clearly it stuck with you today because I see your gold chain, honey.
Oh, you know, this is, you know. And I was singing karaoke last night. You know, I had to put in some Warren G and Nate Dogg to regulate.
You see,
I don't know if East Coast people know that.
I was going to take it easy on you and not ask you to rap on TV, but you brought this on yourself.
I'm not.
You brought it on yourself.
Give us a little taste of what you did last night.
You just had like an amazing singer. How can I compete, you know?
Okay, that's okay.
Well, it's your fault.
Oh God, I can't. This is
just a little warning.
Can I divert? I am making a song with Too Short. I am making a song with Too Short. That's coming out. And you guys can check out the video. So I was on his music video on a song called You Came to Party, which happened to be on the soundtrack of Silicon Valley last season. So that's how I met him. And actually before I got into comedy, I was making beats. So he liked some of my beats, so now me and him's making a song. It's called Young, Rich, and Asian.
That is amazing. Yeah. So clearly you've made the right career move because you're a stand-up comedian, you're an author, you're on TV, you're in movies. I mean, let's talk about Patriots Day, where you were acting with legends like Mark Wahlberg and John Goodman. What was that experience like?
It was incredible, and it was my first drama and my first feature film role.
Wow.
So it was like emotionally it was tough, and it was a movie. The movie was based on the real life event of the marathon bombing that happened in Boston in 2013. So it wasn't just a movie about us, like the actors. It was a movie that we're trying to pay, you know, homage and honor the victims and the heroes in the movie. And I play this based on real life character called Danny Meng. At the end of the day, you know, it was hard, but it was like one of the most rewarding experiences. I was nervous, but I think I got through it pretty
good. You did great, because a lot of critics are calling it your, you know, breakout performance and how, you know, you really showed your versatility to be able to be funny and then start a drama and be like the hero as well.
Yeah.
So
it's amazing, because not a lot of comedians can make that transition. We've seen a lot try and fail
badly.
Not mentioning any names.
Right, that's cool.
Moving swiftly on.
So from the dramedy, back to the comedy, Melissa McCarthy, you guys are going to be at a movie coming up. You just wrapped production on that. Tell us about it. It sounds awesome.
Yeah, so the movie is called Life of the Party, starring Melissa McCarthy. And so she basically goes back to college as a middle-aged woman and joins her daughter's sorority.
Oh, Lord.
The embarrassment from her daughter, and then she's trying to party as a, you know, middle-aged mom. I play her daughter's boyfriend. Now, that doesn't sound like, that sound like an everyday role, right?
Yes.
But for an Asian dude to play a white girl's boyfriend in a movie, that's a big deal. Because you don't really see it that way. Usually you see the Asian girl with the white dude. I'm trying to change the landscape here, you know? I'm trying to balance things
out. Taking big steps, I see that.
Yeah.
What else is on the horizon for you? Because it sounds like you're doing everything that there is humanly possible to do. I can't imagine there's anything left that you haven't already conquered. Well, but if there is, what is it?
I'm getting really busy, you know, pushing this book. It just came out this week, so I really want everybody to read it. And also, I do talk about it in this book also, this movie coming out in August called Crazy Rich Asians. It's based on a best-selling book of the same name, and it's the first studio movie in 25 years since Joy Luck Club that features a whole, like, full Asian cast.
Wow.
So hopefully, I'm not trying to jinx it or anything, that could be our Black Panthers.
I love the fact that it seems like studios are starting to pay attention.
I know,
they're like,
so
let's
huge.
Make an all-Black cast. Oh, now let's make an all-Asian cast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You guys are good. You're going to dominate the box office, because if you're in it, I'm watching.
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
And real before you go, what would you hope people would get out of this book?
Mm-hmm. So, I, you know, there's a lot of debates going on about immigration, DACA, and stuff like that in the news all the time. And I didn't want to make this book, you know, like a partisan issue or anything like that. I just want to share my story in a very honest, humorous, easy-to-read way from an immigrant-first point of view. So I want immigrants, other people that's going through the assimilation process, to relate to this, other Asian people, other African people to relate to this book. Yeah. But also, I want people that maybe just grew up in America to see it from my point of view mm-hmm. and get a more honest opinion on what it's like to be an immigrant.
Mm-hmm. And then it'll teach tolerance as well, foster
exactly.
some sort of acceptance in
exactly.
society.
Instead of arguing, that. I think exactly. it's better to show a real story and yeah. have them come up with their own opinion afterwards.
Amazing. So March 25th, yes. Little Birdie told me, is a very special day.
Yes.
Because, of course, Silicon Valley is back on our screen.
Fifth season.
Wait.
Fifth already? Wow.
Yeah, I know. Because we only do 10 episodes, so it doesn't seem like
right,
it's a lot,
right.
but each episode's good. This season, I'm looking
each
forward to
it. Each episode is great.
Drop some bombs. What can we expect?
So this is the first season without TJ Miller, which I was kind of worried at first, but mm-hmm. it actually became a blessing in disguise because it let my character fly a little more mm-hmm. and kind of go outside the realm of the hacker house. So I kind of get in the face and bother and run into a lot of other enemies. Ooh. And I kind of try to take over the incubator.
Okay. Well, while we wait in anticipation for yes. the next season of Silicon Valley to come mm-hmm. to our screens, go out and watch Jimmy buy his book, How to American, An Immigrant's Guide to Disappointing Your Parents, and we will be right back.
I love it.
Good job. Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Awesome. You're the best.